Hi, I'm the Space Quest historian, and I'm outside in the wild. I'm in front of the Royal Danish Library, and I'm about to go meet a dude named Allan, and he's got a massive collection of games. And he's particularly fond of adventure games. It is very hard to capture all of this in all this glory in one shot. Dear God. So, well, thank you so much for inviting me. This is Allan. Hello, yes. Allan.
Hey.
and your role in all of this is.
I collect old games that we are missing in the national collection. Specifically, I try to get every Danish developed game from before the library officially started receiving them by law. We received two copies of every physically released game, but that was only from 1998 and forward. I personally think that it's important that we try and get everything that was released before then, so we could get the roots of the Danish game development.
And right. And you, good sir.
Yeah, I'm Jacob. Hi.
Hi, Jacob.
Hi.
What's your role in all of this?
What's my role? It's pretty much the same as Alan's, except maybe I do more of the contemporary stuff, like what comes out now.
Right.
Try my best to register all the new games that come, so we don't end up having to hire someone like Allan in 20 years to collect the stuff that comes out now.
Oh yeah, there we go. Did you go for a swim or something?
No, you always need to keep a towel handy.
Is that a conservation, like, mantra? Always keep a towel handy, or is that a Douglas Adams thing?
You should do both in either case, but yes, it's a Douglas Adams thing.
Ah, okay.
So, when we collect games, purchase or collect them by legal as in we are by law required to get some, a lot of these need to in some way be preserved from the original media. Obviously, most DVDs and CDs have a fairly long shelf life before they start having trouble, but we need to preserve them, even more so when it comes to, say, PSP games, physical copies, cartridges from everything, Commodore 64 and Game Boy games and all those things. And we need to take the contents of these cartridges or CDs or floppy disks and make digital copies.
Basically ROM dump.
Yeah, in some cases. And to do this, we obviously need some, of course, a PC to do this on. We have this Cryoflux drive, which is often used in software preservation to make copies of 5.25-inch floppies and 3.5-inch floppies. And it then makes complete magnetic copies, so it doesn't try to read the contents as such. It makes a complete image of everything as it is, without verifying whether it's functional or not.
Right, so you can get past disk booters and copy protection and stuff like that.
Yes, exactly.
So you've got a bunch of consoles and stuff over here.
Yes, so say if you are in the unfortunate business of having to archive the Danish-developed Ouya games, which we did.
Oh God.
You had to download it on an Ouya console, and then you, of course, had to take the downloaded packages out of the Ouya console, which was fairly easy, so that's been handled.
Do you have a Ouya console down there somewhere?
Oh, we do.
I've never actually seen one in the wild.
Somewhere, I think we have it in a box somewhere.
Yeah, you only have the good consoles on display, I see. You have a Wii U and a...
No, we also have an Xbox.
Oh, you also have an Xbox.
For all these digital consoles, we obviously have to download things from the game stores if they aren't released physically, and then we have to somehow dump the contents of them. And for that, we need these, but we also need them in case people want to actually interact with our collection in any way. So the general Danish public can actually just show up here at the library, as a library should, and allow people not to... You can't actually borrow the
Oh, no, I can't check them out and take them home with you.
But if you go to the reading... what's the term I'm looking for?
Reading hall? Something.
Study halls.
Study hall, yeah.
Yeah. Then you can ask to access some parts of the Danish collection, and we'll try as much as possible to make sure you can actually play the game.
So like 10 years from now, you can actually go into the Royal Danish Library, go into the study hall, ring some bell that makes you appear in a puff of smoke and say, I would really like to play Limbo on the original PS3 release or something.
See. We can make sure you can play the PS3 release. We can't necessarily make sure you can play it on the original hardware. Given that this is a long-term preservation project, the goal is to make sure that people can play these in 100 years or more.
Mm-hmm.
They should outlive us if absolutely possible, which is why we dumped the contents.
Right. Absolutely.
Because physical media and... even more so, the consoles die at some point. At some point, there are no more parts to save. There are no more people who know how to build or replace or repair.
Mm.
And then we need something. That's where emulators and virtual machines and that sort of thing enters the picture. So I've been buying up old games we're missing recently. And these include... Rotor... here released by Arcana, is made by a company that, while isn't Danish, is filled with Danish developers.
Oh. This is the Amiga version, I see.
Rotor is a sort of shoot 'em up game, and I've already made sure to image that, so we have it. But we also have an Atari ST version.
What is this?
North Sea Inferno is the localized German title of the game, which is otherwise called Persian Gulf Inferno.
Oh, I can probably see why they wouldn't think that would fly internationally.
So, obviously, Magic Byte is the publisher, not the developer. But as you can see...
There's a lot of German names there. So this is an example of someone pretty much erasing the original developer from the game.
Yes, that's sadly often the case with these older titles, that internationally there has been huge problems, especially in this period, with people just not getting credited at all.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they did, it was only in-game and not in the manual.
Sometimes only through an Easter egg.
Yes.
The Atari games were strictly don't credit the author.
Yes, so the Japanese scene had this tendency of not only not crediting the game, but trying to If there is a credit listing, making sure to use aliases for the developers so other companies wouldn't know who was working there so they could offer them better jobs.
Right.
Otherwise, we have a chain reaction. That's by a Danish guy called Mads Borg.
This is a C64 version. I remember these old, weird sort of jewel case-ish boxes that C64 games came in, but there's actually a 5 1/4 floppy disk in there somewhere, isn't there?
There is.
Yeah, they were a bitch to get open, too. He's not struggling for my benefit. There we go. Oh, that is beautiful.
Also have Sword of Sodan. So this was also released for the Sega Mega Drive, which wasn't officially sanctioned by the developer, Sodan. That's Søren from Denmark.
Oh my god, Søren from Denmark, yeah. Sodan.
Yeah,
he so was, that's his sword. His sword is inside that game box.
Yeah, we'll have to assume. I also assume that's him on the cover.
Probably an artist rendition, I would think.
Nah, man. But they did make a Mega Drive version of this originally Amiga game. Which I believe was played at this year's AGDQ.
Okay, looks like we are ready to go here, so I'm going to go ahead and throw it over to NPC for Sword of Sodan. 3, 2, 1, go. Woo! Probably won't see right now is that there are pits in this level.
I'm hoping no
pits.
We're
hoping we don't see the pits.
Well, actually, everybody is hoping for pits because this is what people donated for.
Well, that's true.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, I'm going to... Oh, well,
NPC.
Oh. It's terrible. Absolutely awful.
Oh.
But it looks gorgeous. Then we have...
Oh, dear God. So I'm used to seeing, like, Danish games on the IBM PC and the C64, because those were the systems of the late 80s and early 90s that I was used to. I'm not used to seeing Danish developers on platforms like international console platforms like the Sega.
Yeah, this for a short period there was a bunch of now IO people making games for the Sega consoles. One of them in a big box copy. Scavenger is, as far as I remember, primarily former IO people, now IO people.
Mm.
You also have the Danish...
of course.
Strip poker. Hopefully you can show this without having to...
I don't think I have to blur this display of 80s boner material.
So a lot was written about this in the Danish computer magazine.
I have to get a full shot of you holding this. It's just fantastic.
So at the time, the Danish computer magazines were fairly sleazy things run by primarily students.
Mm-hmm.
And they spent a lot of pages writing about this and how Trine Mikkelsen, the Danish... porn actress. Appeared, and there was an interview with her where she talked about. They asked her if she how she had felt about the whole thing. She wasn't really aware that video games were a thing. So she was just invited by a friend to have some pictures taken for a project, and she was paid, I think, 1,000 Danish kroner. When asked how she felt about this after hearing how well it had sold, which, I mean, it was widespread. I'm not sure it actually sold all that well. I believe this is a prime candidate for being cracked and distributed.
Yeah, this is a Leisure Suit Larry territory where there are more pirated copies than actual sold copies.
Yeah. But she thought she would probably have asked for more if she did it again. But she heard that several of the other girls hadn't been paid, so overall she was... So if that is what does it for you, there are...
This is your 80s boner right here, people.
So, we also do various other types of digital forensics work. Digital forensic is the term for trying to dump or save the contents of old media in other forms. And making sure that it's exactly the same as what was on the disc.
Right.
So you can use it in court cases, which is why it's forensic.
Which is an interesting term to use when you're talking about digital preservation. One would assume that the reason why you're doing all this is because it's culturally significant and it's an art form. That's why you want to keep it. But there's that whole other side of it where, like, if a game developer goes out and murders someone and he left a clue in his Atari game from 1987 or something, I don't know.
Yeah, we also do tons of other stuff in that vein.
Yeah, what's all this then?
That's a bunch of old Macintosh computers, which will probably be used to make sure that we have the ability to run older QuickTime-based video games from the 1998-ish era.
Yeah, that black hole of Macromedia Director games.
Yeah, that's the pits.
They are indeed the pits, because they're impossible to emulate. And they're impossible to run unless you have either the original hardware or a really good virtual machine.
Yes. We are working on creating or adapting a virtual machine environment that dynamically makes virtual machines for specific software from various eras. It's an international project that we are looking into, hopefully being able to adapt and put on the in the reading halls.
Yeah.
Study halls. We also have... This is a device, Dragon Box. And so this baby slots right into by a USB port to a PC.
Mm-hmm.
And then it allows you to just dump the contents of ROMs directly in Windows by drag and dropping.
Oh.
And it's pretty sweet.
So...
obviously, you shouldn't do that. That is for me to do. Instead, you should just put it in and then insert your...
The controllers and...
Yeah, and play directly in your emulator of choice on your PC.
Of course, yeah. These are for professionals, kids. Which brings me to an interesting question. Abandonware is a whole murky situation on its own.
Well, abandonware isn't a murky situation. People think it's a murky situation. Abandonware isn't legal.
It's not. No, it's pirated. But there are no copyright holders to sue you, technically.
Yes. That does not make it legal.
No.
That just means that there is no one... there are also always owners. I don't think the owners can disappear as such. The rights are always transferred in one way or the other. But finding out who has the rights would often require some sort of courtroom drama of some fashion. I mean, generally in the software preservation business, we advise people to... It's much better if people pirate and save things in that fashion than if they don't and it just disappears.
Right. So you do have a pro-abandonware stance.
Yes.
Right. Have you ever had an instance where a Danish developed game had, you know, the rights blown to the winds and the developers had fucked off to some country you've never heard of and no one knew where it was except for on some obscure abandonware site.
Oh yeah. So there's a ton of games that where we either don't know who made them, who is where the original licensor is today, and this is for the entire 80s era of games that are often the case. I've personally hunted down several developers and asked for if we could maybe use their games in various contexts. And usually these people are just super happy that people are still care and try to preserve their things. It also helps to that we are represented by a state organization. So people in the industry generally really want to be taken seriously, be seen as making things that count as art. And one step of that is having people contact you and say, we want to preserve this for posterity. And I believe that feels quite good, except if you've made some really embarrassing...
Where did it go? Where is that? There it is. Now, I'm quite sure they're actually pretty proud of this.
Yeah, emotional software, I believe they were called.
What, really? Emotional software?
Yes.
So what emotion are they going for, you think?
I think you know what emotion... So obviously I'm going through various purchases of Danish localized games, trying to find out what we have, what we were missing, what we know existed.
And here we have a dashing Danish programmer, resplendent in his battle uniform.
Yes, notice the company, Keleline. So, there was a scathing article in the computer magazines at the time about Keleline because the owner had decided that there was no reason to pay his programmers for the games they had made.
Oh no.
He had found this really cool way of creating a daughter company so he could transfer the rights to there, and then the contracts he had made with these people would no longer count work. And suddenly no one never heard anything about him again from him. Just completely disappeared.
So this is actually, this should be a wanted poster, really.
Yeah, most of the, many of the games here are from their Mac down there was finished at another company after Keleline was just shut down.
Oh my god.
That poster down there, Starvision International, that was a company made by Sodan, Søren Grønbæk, the guy who made Sort of Sodan. Notice the exactly one of those games exist, and it's the second last one, and it's not under that name. What does that say?
It says Snowberry.
Yes, and what is the picture of?
Well, it's a little teddy bear with a Swedish flag on it.
And?
And it's Super Oswald.
It is
Snowberry.
So that was obviously not released at this company. Actually, not a single game was released. He tried to make it big in America, but I don't think any of his games were actually released besides Super Oswald. So
did he just steal Super Oswald, or was he...
No.
This was legit.
So this was right after Keleline had tried to make off with all the money for the game he had developed for them. So he decided to make his own company and brought in tons of the other people who had worked on games at Keleline who were also getting screwed.
Understandably frustrated people.
Yes. And apparently they made games at Starvation until they eventually ended up releasing them on other companies. Mm-hmm. I'm still not sure entirely what happened. The Terminator here.
Is that a Danish-developed game?
If you notice at the bottom, it says Bethesda Softworks.
Yeah.
So Bethesda isn't Danish, but Julian and a couple of the other major programmers and developers in the early Bethesda days were Danish developers, including the people working on Elder Scrolls Arena.
Oh.
And several others early Elder Scrolls titles, not to mention the Terminator games.
Skynet is also...
Yes.
Technically, Skynet is in the Royal Danish Library because prominent Danish developers worked on it.
Yes.
I did not know that.
I'm actually not sure I have Skynet yet. But
you should. It has amazing FMV sequences.
No, that's not true. These are always super fascinating to sift through, and I highly recommend it. This is an anti-piracy ad.
From Ocean.
Yes.
That's a bit pot to kettle, if you don't mind me saying.
That's because people were using computers, or obviously you have to talk about space.
Mm-hmm. I actually saw this in your office as well.
Yes.
But now
I
that
think
it's...
you are probably better equipped to explain what this is than I am, me being basically a child.
This, I don't know. This was, I don't know, it's kind of like the Mountain Dew of the 80s in Denmark. It's basically just a lime soda. And apparently they were really into busting TVs.
Spock, Justin Beck. It was in the computer magazine for Commodore games, and I do remember they had a competition where you could send in something, game ideas or something, and then you could win some spark.
It's interesting how the stereotypical soft drink of choice for computer geeks is always lime, some sort of lime soda.
It's
Mountain
because
Dew
we
in
are
America.
So incredibly sporty people, and that's the sporty taste. And we needed to keep our reflexes high for those action sequences poorly implemented in point-and-click adventure games.
Yes. So this is when you dart out of the elevator and leave me in here and try to work out how to get up through an airbender or something?
Yeah, pretty much.
Oh. That concludes my journey to the Royal Danish Library, and they're, oh, Jesus, this thing is peaking. My big thanks to Allan for inviting me, and thank you guys for watching. Please like, subscribe, do whatever you kids do, but do leave me a comment, because I quite enjoy the comments. I hope you found this interesting, and if you're ever in town, my advice is, of course, to hit up Allan. I'm going to leave a link to his Twitter profile in the comments, so you can hit him up, and maybe even... swing by for a visit. And if you have any donations, of course, they would really like donations for you know, any game that is even remotely Danish, apparently. So but anyway, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you around the Corona stream.